are you for this series? I cannot wait till August 5th. I've got a little sneak preview, and I can tell you, they are fabulous. I've always been a Neil Gaiman fan, and I was so excited to hear that this was actually coming to life. Are you guys having a good Comic-Con? Are you ready to meet the geniuses and the incredible cast behind the Sandman? All right, I would love to bring up our panel, starting with Neil Gaiman. There you are. Oh, the man with the dulcet tones. Okay, next, we are going to bring up in my order here, Allan Heinberg, Tom Sturridge, Vivienne Acheampong, Boyd Holbrook, Gwendoline Christie, Jenna Coleman, Kirby Howell-Baptiste, Mason Alexander Park, and Vanesu, Samunyai. And of course, Patton Oswalt. He's like the cherry on top of an awesome sundae. Now, this is such an incredibly, massively talented cast. I'd like to start the questions, of course, with our creators here. This has been 30 years in the making. How does it feel to bring your characters to life on screen?
Really good. really good. What I'm really excited about is just the fact that in less than 2 weeks, everybody's going to get to see what we made. And I'm so excited about it, so proud of it, and so incredibly thrilled that it's here. I'm a fan. I love what we've done. So it feels very good.
Comic. How did you go about crafting an authentic adaptation for television? This one will be for you, Alan.
Oh, well, I did it as a fan. I mean, I was a huge fan of the books, and I was reading them monthly when they were coming out, because I'm old. And in a show about dreams, it's been oddly fitting from the start that this show has been a dream come true from the beginning for me. So I got involved basically at a point where Neil and David Goyer were going to develop it for streaming, and my only condition of joining the team was that I be able to make a Sandman experience that was as faithful to the book as possible, and luckily that's exactly what Neil and David had in mind as well. And Warner Brothers backed us the entire way, and Netflix has been incredibly supportive of that mission. We knew that streaming was the only way we were going to be able to tell the story properly, and they, studio and network, have backed us the entire way, and we have this amazing cast, far beyond anything I could have dreamed.
I mean, speaking of the cast, how did you go about the casting process? How were the chosen?
Well, first of all, we have Lucinda Sison as our casting director, who's amazing. I'd worked with her years ago on Stardust, and getting to work with her again is a delight. And the casting process was sort of different for every single person down on this panel. They were all cast differently. Tom was there in the first email from Lucinda. She sent us 4 audition tapes, and Tom's was obviously the best, and I figured that there would soon we'd have a dozen like him, and you know, he was there, and then we saw another 50 or 60 people, and it was still just Tom, and then we saw several hundred more people, and it was still just Tom. And by the end of the process, I think we'd seen about 1,000 auditions. And poor Lucinda Sison must have seen anywhere between 5,000 and 6,000 Sandman auditions, and it was still Tom. So we cast Tom.
Love at first sight.
And beyond that, people down there, let's see, Gwendoline.
Clearly a fan favorite.
We just sort of went to her and said, do you want to be in Sandman? She said, yeah, I want to be Lucifer. And we went, yeah. That was basically that happened. That was incredibly easy. Jenna was harder. We definitely auditioned a bunch of Joanna Constantines, and we assumed we would have our pick of people, and there was nobody that we liked. And then I suggested Jenna, having worked with her on Doctor Who a long time ago. And she was amazing, so she got the part. And then we forgot that we'd ever asked anybody, because she just sort of occupied our hearts. Let's see, Mason tweeted me.
That's all it took?
Mason tweeted me, and Mason being very sensible.
Neil Gaiman, I would like.
Basically, they tweeted me and said, has Desire been cast? And who is your casting director? And I thought, that is a very professional sort of question. So I went and looked at their videos and thought, they're really good, and sent a thing over to Allan saying, hey, just thought, this is interesting, just thought you'd like to know. And then they aced the auditions. They weren't the only person to be auditioned, but they aced it. Kirby was sort of upside down from Tom. Tom was there at the very first, and then we had to watch 1,500 other auditions of people failing to say the lines right. Kirby, we had watched hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of deaths, and I had not thought saying things about, you know, you're a sorriest excuse for an anthropomorphic personification or this or any other plane would be difficult to say, but it turns out that it's not the easiest line to deliver convincingly. And then we saw Kirby, and we believed her. We believed her as death. We believed that she could actually tell Tom's Morpheus a thing or two and he would listen. And we believed that people would fall in love with death on the screen in the same way that they had in the comics. So we cast Kirby.
That was the same for Vanesu as well. Vanesu, we read so many roses, and the second Vanesu came up on my screen, the computer screen, that there was only ever her. Boyd had a harder time of it. It was 6 months between like audition tape and us calling. Yeah, that was a really hard role. Really hard role.
Completely forgot about the project.
Yeah.
That didn't work out.
I heard Patton was the first to be cast.
That is true.
And before he even knew it, he was already in it.
Patton was cast before Allan was on board.
Yeah.
And Patton was cast before we told Patton that he was cast. We just knew that, you know, he would fit into that Raven costume.
Yes. Well, he fit into the Ratatouille costume, so it only makes sense that he would fit into the Raven costume.
I basically just dyed it black and stuck a beak on it. Like, there's not a lot of... But it worked. It worked perfectly, yeah. Yeah.
So, Tom, Dream is not an easy role, and I know that you are a fan of the comics. How did you prepare?
Oh, man. I think the first thing is I care so deeply about this piece of literature. And I think the only way that you can begin to understand them is to subsume yourself in the words and the images that Neil created. And so I just spent months, because the casting process was a long one, reading it over and over again until it was in my bones and in my blood. And I think that there is no more honest way to try and find a character than to try and get inside the mind of the man who made it.
Well, I have to tell you, as an insomniac, a sleepwalker and someone who has a lot of crazy issues with sleeping, a hot gothic guy in a trench coat that can make you sleep on command, pretty much you are my number one hottie right now. Amazing. You're the only actor that's got to work with everybody on stage because you're in you're the entire show. So, I mean, how is it to keep all the stories just cohesive in your brain? How is it to work with everybody throughout the whole series?
I think what's exquisite about our show is that each episode is a different film. It's an entirely different story, but within this cohesive world. And it was so thrilling to every month come to set and meet this extraordinary group of human beings. And to learn and change, and specifically as the character to change, because the key with our story is that Dream goes on a journey and he becomes someone who he isn't at the beginning. And that change was inflicted by the performances of these wonderful people.
Vivienne, you've got an incredible role as the librarian of dreaming. It's a very unique sort of guardian role, and it spans all of the stories throughout the entire series. What resonates with you about that character specifically?
Oh, wow. I love how stoic and still she is, because that ain't me. Quite the opposite to me. And just this bond that she has with Dream, that she, you know, takes care of the Dream in his absence. And one of the things that I absolutely loved is that she knows every book that has ever been written, every book that has ever been told or even imagined, and I just love that concept. And just the concept of dreaming as well, because I'm someone that really, since I've been a child, has really tried to interpret dreams and what they mean, how they affect us, how they, what our unconscious mind is doing. So I absolutely fell in love, such a privilege and honor to be Lucy Lane.
You're the boss on this. Like, legit boss.
Yeah.
And Boyd, your character, man. Okay, so your how would you describe your scary, scary character?
I'd say the Corinthian is the creation of your worst nightmare in the dreaming world, and then the patron of saints and the serial killers in the waking world.
Yeah, escaped nightmare. Also, I
think,
amazing. The Corinthian, it's got a lot going on this season. Is there anything specifically you're excited for the fans to see?
I have a particular relationship with a character that's not on the panel today, Jeb, who was really a surprise the whole time. I can't wait for everybody to see that.
For me, big surprise was seeing Gwendoline show up as Lucifer. Man, Lucifer turns around, I was like, yes! I'm one of those people who yells at the television. I was so thrilled at this casting. Was that what you had in mind? It's a little different from what I saw in the comic. It feels like an update.
It's a little bit of an update, but I mean, if you go back to the first ever appearance of Lucifer in the comic, I remember finding some photographs of David Bowie as a young folk singer with permed curly hair, yeah, and just sending those photographs to Sam, Keith, and Mike Dringenberg, who were drawing the comic. And I said, this is the look that we're going for. It's androgynous. It's a junkie angel. This is who Lucifer is. Actually, Gwendoline brings the junkie angel in spades. It's a...
Gwendoline, what did you want to bring to the part? Was it junkie angel?
I'm a one-stop shop for junkie angel. I really was so unbelievably delighted when Allan and Neil came to me about being in Sandman. And we had an incredible conversation. It came about at such an extraordinary point of time where I think this pandemic was just happening. And the connection I felt to both of them and the material really awakened something in me. Because what I think about the Sandman when I read the comics, there is an innate actually, it's fantastical, it's intelligent, it's brilliant, it takes you on a hallucinogenic journey. It also has a spirituality in it that is like Star Wars. It takes you somewhere else. You feel like somehow through reading it, the mysteries of the universe will unfold. And it is absolutely our reality as humans through the prism of glorious fantasy. And the idea of being the very essence of evil through these people's eyes was the most delightful moment I could.
Oh, that is so fantastic. Okay, before we go on with more questions, because we have so many incredible panelists here, how would you guys like to see a clip that's for this room only? Would you like to set up this clip?
Of course. So this is a clip from episode 3. And anybody who read Sandman will remember episode 3, Dream a Little Dream of Me, has John Constantine in it. And for various reasons, we decided that actually, given that we were going to be meeting Joanna Constantine in the past, we might as well have a Joanna Constantine in the present as well. And we found Jenna, and we cast her, mostly obviously because her initials are JC, and it was cheap. So we are at the beginning of the episode. We're actually at a wedding, in a surprise wedding that has been called very late at night, and Joanna Constantine has been summoned by Rick the Vic to see if she can sort something out, because there may be some devilry and demonry afoot.
How hot is Jenna in this? Oh my God. Jenna, Doctor Who, Sandman, you've been a part of some incredible projects. Not a question, I just need to say that out loud. So what does Joanna Constantine get into up this season?
Anybody who's read Hellblazer, Dream a Little Dream of Me, we see Joanna Constantine, help Lord Morpheus find his sand on his journey. And beat some monsters and perform some exorcisms while we're at it.
If you could perform exorcisms before the nuptials, I feel like that's what you should definitely do. that could really save some marriages. So I want to talk a little bit about Rose Walker in this, because Vanesu, we finally get to get a little bit of a glimpse into Rose. What is her journey this season?
So Rose Walker she's an orphan, and she is trying to find her brother, and she, along the way, she has a journey with Morpheus, and that's what she tries to do. She tries to find her brother, and Morpheus is there to help her, kind of.
It's almost like you're guiding each other a little bit. I feel like you guys are learning a lot from each other through the series.
Yeah, there's definitely an evolution.
One of the roles I was very excited about is, so the first time Matthew speaks, I didn't know who was gonna be cast as Matthew, and then Patton Oswalt, I heard his voice, and I was like, yes! And my daughter's like, why are you freaking out? I'm like, it's Patton Oswalt! She's like, who's that? I'm like, Ratatouille, girl! Right, and then she started squealing too.
She said, who's that?
She's a baby. It's okay.
Okay. All right. I'll let that one slide. God.
She's not allowed to listen to your stand-up, Jess.
Oh, well, that's smart parenting, actually. Yeah.
Was this a dream role for you? I know that you're a comics fan. You are clearly geek royalty. I feel like you walk on water at Comic-Con. Right?
It's actually a little weird because Sandman is one of those things that I was into right from the beginning, from issue one. I stood in line for 3 hours in 1992 to get my Season of Mist hardback signed by Neil in San Francisco, but I'm playing a character that is completely new to this world and kind of at sea, like he's, of all people, maybe except Rose, he's running to catch up with this massive world that he's been thrown into. Whereas, you know, the actor playing the Raven is like, well, actually, it's Bella Crotch and Squatter Bloat are both at the portal of hell, and they only have the what? Like, I know every thing that got adapted out and changed, so having to kind of play the not knowing exactly what's going on, sometimes it was a little hard because I knew everything that was happening, you know?
You're great comic relief, because sometimes this gets a little dark. So it's really great to hear you come up and just add a little bit of comedy so we can take a quick breath before we get back into it. I think you do a really incredible job.
You're correct.
I am correct.
Tell your daughter. No.
I'll let her watch the rest of the series when it comes out August 5th, mark your calendars. So we have another clip. I would like, Neil, would you like to introduce the next clip?
Of course. So when we were doing the original comic, Sandman number 8, The Sound of Her Wings, was the one that somehow changed everything. Everybody realized what we were doing, and it all began with Dream and Death sitting on a bench, and in the TV series, it's not episode 8, it's episode 6.
That line, very eloquent. Thank you.
Thank you.
You've got one of those unique relationships to death, Dream in this, as you guys are part of the Endless Siblings. How'd you get into your headspace for this?
Well, I think one of the benefits of, well, I guess it was both good and bad, was filming this during the pandemic. We had a lot of time to ourselves. I had a lot of time to think, and on this more than any other role, I think, because essentially it's how do you, I wouldn't say humanize, but I guess, you know, give a human form to a concept, right, to death. I spent an incredibly long time looking at relationships with death, both in the Western world and in other places, and I became very obsessed with the idea of psychopomps, right? These people that would guide, these entities that guide people from this life to the next, and this idea that there could be dignity in death, and there could be, there's a hopefulness rather than just what we traditionally see, which is doom and gloom. And I think what I got to do was, I got to, take from the page what I think so many people related to, the idea that Neil created, which is when you are in your final moments, you want to be comforted, you want to be with the person that you want to get a drink with, and rather than this idea of this looming character that made you feel awful at the time, it was better that you were with someone that you felt comfortable with, who you could talk to. And for me, it was an amazing opportunity. I got to delve inside of myself and explore my own relationship with death and the way I felt about it. And I had a personal loss that I think I was able to sort of work through in playing death. So this was an absolutely incredible experience for me. And when I read the comic, death was one of the characters that was my absolute favorite. And I read it years ago. So I don't think I could have ever imagined then that I would get the opportunity to bring that role to life.
Clearly, I'm a fan too. I'm cosplaying you today.
I love it.
We're going to take some audience questions coming up in a few minutes. So if you guys want to start lining up for that, there's a microphone. I want to talk about the Endless Siblings. So Tom and Mason, which, by the way, Desire is just sexy. You purr and crawl across screen in a way that just brings Desire to life. Death, Desire, Dream. How would you guys talk about that endless relationship between the three of you?
I'm glad everyone's looking at me because I haven't spoken. you know, funny enough, like I got to work with everybody, with Tom and Donna, who plays Despair, were my, you know, two scene partners during this season. And I worked with them collectively over the course of one day. So we sort of had to do a lot of, you know, homework on our own and really trust the text and trust the relationships that Neil, you know, kind of crafted in the original comics. And I think that that really helped a lot as a performer and as an actor, because then once we got on there, like, you know, standing in front of someone like Tom as Dream, you're like, oh, this is Dream. It's very easy to accept that reality. And so, you know, we had these beautiful practical sets, and my threshold is brought to life pretty splendidly, I think, in the series. And so I think the immersion and the having some kind of actual physical context for what the show should feel like, and that kind of coming directly from the comics really helped to sort of be like, okay, now I can just trust, you know, what's on the page and sort of do my best you know, version of whatever I think that this is at the moment, and it might change, but but what's really exciting is, you know, they put together this amazing cast of people that really, really are the thing that they are. You know, we are the people that we're playing in a unique and enjoyable way. So yeah, I hope that's from my perspective.
Did you get that sibling feeling when you guys were getting into the headspace of this role?
Of course, yeah. I mean, you know, my dynamic with Tom is very different from that of any of the other siblings. It's, you know, we all have our own individual relationships. So it was fun to sort of, like, my first scene, I think, is was my last scene. And it's kind of dastardly and very, I mean, it's the ultimate sibling rivalry, I think. but, you know, Donna's remarkable too, we have a completely different relationship that Allan and Neil both filled in the blanks so beautifully for me as a performer that, you know, it just helped, because on the day you just kind of did your best.
You guys bring out such layers of story in each other every time there's two of you on screen. It's really beautifully put together in a way that you can, there's just so much story that's layered up on top of each other that every little bite that comes out is just something to... I'm getting a little too fangirl up here. Does anybody else want to talk about this? How about some questions?
Hello.
Hello.
Nice to meet you. I'm Nika Holt. My question is, will we get to see a Funko Pop of Murr the Pumpkin or any characters in the Sandman series anytime soon in your nearest local store?
How's the merchandising going?
They do not share mysterious marketing and manufacturing and spin-off wisdom with us. So I, just like you, I would like a Murr Pumpkinhead Funko Pop, because it will be the coolest thing in the world. Murr, by the way, for anybody who does not know this, is voiced by Mark Hamill. And is in every way perfect. I think that's fair.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. So I'm only hoping that, obviously, people will watch this and go, we all need Murr Pumpkinhead Funko Pops. We all need Goldie the Gargoyle. We will need little Cains and Abels that murder each other. We will need full-size Desires to stand in the corner of our rooms and fall in love with us. We will need all of these things, and I hope they will make them all.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Jenny.
Hi, Jenny.
Hi, Jenny.
Hi, Jenny. My question's for Mason. This kind of springboard off of what you were just talking about. So I know you more as a stage actor. I met you at the stage door of Hedwig and the Angry Inch. Woo! And so I was wondering how, like, your preparation for this role compares to preparing for a role like that, where you're playing the same character over and over again, whereas this, you have this whole history and mythos behind it.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's, you know, there's a massive difference between film and television prep and theater prep, just in the fact that, like, you never really get a lot of time to actually rehearse, and I think that that's when people really work out a lot of the kinks and or figure things out. So for me, I feel like I was really lucky that I only shot in such a limited time on this show, because it gave me such a limited view. I don't really know how to describe it. It made me focus much more on just the words and what I wanted the relationship to be in the present, and less about like, oh, this is going to be captured forever and ever and ever, and people are going to see it, you know, 10 years from now and laugh at me. You know, like you can't think about those things in the moment, whereas with theater, like, you're doing it over and over again, and it naturally changes and shifts. So I just kind of gave it my best go. But we also have John Cameron Mitchell, who's, you know, the original Hedwig, plays Hal in the series, and so we got to hang out a little bit on the days that we were both filming, and that was quite a delight. Thank you.
Is anybody cosplaying as any of the characters today? So I have a feeling next year I'm going to see a lot of desires, a lot of dreams, a lot of deaths.
Maybe some sexy ravens.
Maybe some sexy, sexy ravens.
Thank you. Putting it out there.
Question over here?
Hi, guys.
Oh, hi.
I just lost my question. Sorry. I'm good. Neil, thank you for 50 viewings of Stardust with my family. Now that you've adapted Sandman to multiple mediums, and they say that you write what you know, I wanted to ask, how do you keep the story you've created true to yourself at all levels?
I think I'm incredibly lucky that nobody has wanted to change what we did. When I was making Sandman originally, DC Comics were very content to let me do this thing because they had no idea what I was doing or how to do it, so they let me do it. Doing the Audible adaptation, this wonderful adaptation that Dirk Maggs, James McAvoy, and everybody has been doing. Audible wanted Sandman, so we did Sandman. And what was lovely was feeling like we'd done something that was so faithful. It's basically an audiobook of the original comics, of graphic novels. It kind of freed us a little bit in making this to go, okay, we're making television, we're putting something on the screen. How do we do that? And originally I was making comics. There were 24 pages in each comic and 6, maybe 7 panels on the page, and I could only do so much, but now we actually have things that move around, and how are we going to make that work? How are we going to make people cry? How are we going to make people laugh? How are we going to be true to Sandman? Because, as far as I'm concerned, how do I put this politely? Everybody in this hall is yogurt starter. You guys have read Sandman. And you, I hope, like Sandman. And you're interested in Sandman, and you're gonna watch that Netflix Sandman, and you're gonna watch it going, yeah, okay, this better be good. And if it is good, you're gonna tell everybody you know to watch Sandman. And you're gonna find people you don't know, and you'll start conversations with them while waiting for pizza or something, saying, hey, there's a thing called Sandman on Netflix, it's amazing, you've gotta watch it. But you only do that if you like Sandman. So from my perspective, we're kind of making Sandman for you guys as yogurt starter to go out to turn the entire world into yogurt. That's... It's a very strange analogy, but I hope you enjoy it. But we made this Sandman for you guys, and now you have to go out and convert the world once you've seen it.
I can't wait for it to premiere because I am yogurt and I'm tired of not talking about it. So what's our next question over here?
Hi, my name is Nick. In the comments, we see the saga of the Sandman unfold through several styles of art. I always related the changing styles to the way that something so familiar can evolve before your eyes in a dream. Is that something we can expect to see in the show?
Yes.
Well, each episode's unique, right? Yes. The styling, the
I will say a lot of that, you know, the directors of the episodes fulfill the sort of
the role in some ways that the artists fulfilled for the comic. And we were blessed. Mike Barker did an incredible job on our pilot, and our producing director, Jamie Childs, who is here in the audience. Yeah. He directed episodes 2, 3, 4, and 5, and really, really did an astonishing job. So the show has a visual look that is very much Jamie's, and it is as distinctive as it is deeply emotional. So we didn't do anything that wasn't tied to the emotional effect it would have on the audience. But we were very much trying to do right by the incredible artists who graced, you know, the art of these issues originally. So,
and can I tell them a secret?
Let's do it. It's only 6,000 people.
So when Sandman began, people kept saying to me, is Dave McKean going to do anything for Sandman? And Dave, after literally 30 years of Sandman covers and Sandman graphic novels and redesigns and redesigns and redesigns, had retired formally from doing Sandman books. He was like, okay, can I stop now? And I said, yes, you can stop. But I called Dave and said, we're doing the TV show. You have to do something. And so every episode has end title credits, and it has an end sequence, and it's a different sequence for each episode, this amazing sort of kaleidoscopic flowing little film that's our end credit thing that Dave McKean made. He's made 10 of them for us, and they're beautiful.
So don't skip the credits, watch the credits.
Yes, do not skip the end credits, just watch, it's pretty.
We have another question over here.
Hi, I'm Rob.
Hi, Rob.
Lucifer is frequently portrayed as one-dimensionally evil, but some interpretations see Lucifer as more like a Prometheus figure, where the Lucifer as Lightbringer can represent intellectualism, drive for knowledge and curiosity. And when you have a performer as brilliant as Gwendoline and somebody with as much knowledge of myths as Neil, and a lot of episodes with more dialogue than comics potentially, could we see those aspects of Lucifer or other aspects we may not have seen in prior depictions in other media?
Yeah, everything you said is in the episodes. That's incredibly generous of you. I think that I just went back to the comics. I know that everybody was so devoted to making those comics come alive. And when you're aware that there's a huge fan base of something that initially felt very underground, very special, not so many people knew about it, and then the love for it has really grown, there's a kind of responsibility that I feel that goes with that. So I also love that Neil and Allan were really open to my interpretation. So what I love about reading the comic books of Sandman is that my imagination really fires. I get to see these incredible artworks, I read Neil's beautiful words, and things come alive in my mind. And there is something about realizing that Lucifer is a fallen angel. Lucifer was God's favorite, and then has been cast out. And what that means. And what that means to me, the idea that we can all relate to of a lifetime of disappointments. And what that does. Also, with the kind of landscape of our lives at the moment, I think we've all started to realize that a lack of empathy is evil. Disconnection is evil. So I felt very, very, very honored to be able to bring my own thoughts to it and also to embody this incredible character that these amazing people have helped bring to life.
That's a good question.
I also want to give a shout out to the practical makeup effects that are in Hell. That was my favorite episode for all of the both makeup and the CGI was really well done. Like, it feels real. Do you want to give a shout out to any of the effects artists?
Ian Markowitz, who is our VFX supervisor, is here today. And he is a wizard and a genius and a miracle worker. And Gary Steele is our production designer. He's here today. He made it hell with his own hands. Cassie Clare plays Mazakine, and she did an incredible job. Who am I leaving out? Graham, who did our makeup. She's a combination of makeup and VFX. Squatter Blow he's a professional, well, I don't remember. This is terrible. I apologize if you're watching. But he's a professional actor and fighter, and he's a human mountain. We were gonna do maybe experiment with a CGI Squatter Bloat, and then we met him, and we couldn't not put him on television. He was a man mountain and
so terrifying. Huge.
David, I should have done my research. I'm sorry, it was a year ago.
I like man mountain best. So,
yes, in the best sense.
I think he'd like that too.
Hashtag man mountain.
Yeah.
Do we have another question?
Hi. Hi, nice to meet everybody. Thank you so much. I became a screenwriter because of you, Neil, so you and my dad, so thank you so much.
Oh, I'm so glad. Well done.
This question is for you and the entire panel as collaborators on this adaptation. Neil, you as an artist have grown so much since The Sandman was first released. What is the balance of doing an accurate portrayal of your original material and letting it breathe and change as you have as an artist?
So for me, the strangest process has been one of learning to trust 26, 27, 28-year-old Neil Gaiman and go, actually, you did kind of know what you were doing, and we have to trust you, because there were definitely places where David Goyer and Allan and I came up with brilliant ways to fix things, improve things, change things, and started putting them into practice, and then went, actually that it worked better in the comics, and we just go back to that. So.
I think we have time for maybe one more question.
Hi.
Hi.
This question is specifically for Neil Gaiman. I appreciate all of you, and I'm really excited about this series. But this is my first Comic-Con, and my first time seeing you in person. So I have to take the opportunity to ask you if we will ever see 1602 as a film or series.
What a lovely question. I don't know, that's up to Marvel. I asked about 8 years ago, I said to them, look, wouldn't it make a great film or TV series or something? And the people at the time were like, no, it will never happen. But those people have gone, and new people are there. And I would love to see a 1602 movie or TV series. I think it would be great.
Right on. Okay, one last Sandman question. What you got?
Hi, my name is Rob, and I have a question for Pat and Oswald.
Oh.
So I'm a huge Ratatouille fan, and I wanted to know, have you ever eaten Ratatouille?
Have
I
ever eaten Ratatouille?
Have you ever eaten crow?
I have eaten crow many times in my life, figuratively. I have tried Ratatouille. It's great. It's like yogurt, but more tomato-y.
Well, we're all about to be yogurt now. this has been an incredible panel. I am so blessed to be up here. I can't believe they chose me because I'm a big Sandman fan. So I was so excited when I got this call. I'm like, yes! I think we have to end it with a world premiere. I feel like that's why we come to Comic-Con, right? Neil, would you like to cue up?
I will cue this up. Yes. So here we are at Comic-Con, and we show you unique things. The things that we've shown you so far are only for this panel ever. The thing that we're about to show you, once we have shown it to you here, the rest of the world will get it as well. Because this is the trailer for the Sandman television series from Netflix.
World's and first premiere.
It's first premiere. You're going to get to see everybody on this panel. You'll see Tom and Viv. You'll see Boyd and Gwendolyn. You'll see Jenna, Kirby, Mason, Vanesu, and you may even, if you're lucky, see Patton in his Raven costume.
Sexy Raven. That was the Sandman, Neil Gaiman, Allan, Heinberg, Tom, Sturridge, Vivienne, Acheampong, Boyd, Holbrook, Gwendoline Christie, Jenna Coleman. God, that's a big panel.